Hi there, this is Akrich. So in this video, let's discuss some of the countermeasures against a stack buffer overflow vulnerability. So sometimes what happens is, even though there exists a vulnerability in the program, we cannot exploit it easily. That is because of these countermeasures. So let's discuss few of those countermeasures and possible way to bypass those. Let's get started. So here I have listed some of the countermeasures. First one is a compiler level. It includes stack guard or canary. Second one is hardware level. It includes non-executable stack. Basically, it makes the stack as non-executable. Coming to third one, it is OS level. It includes ASLR. So let's discuss this little bit more in the next slide. So coming to stack guard or canary. So here what compiler does is, whenever it allocates the stack frame for particular function, it will push the stack guard value after the return address. So stack guard is a random value. It will be different for every time we run the program. So basically it's not guessable. So after taking the input from the user, compiler will recheck this guard value. So if it is not same as before, it will throw an error as stack smashed. So here, even though we overwrote the return address, we cannot redirect the control flow as we want. So this is how compiler will add an extra protection for buffer overflow vulnerability using canary. So let's see what kind of error it gives, and also let's see how can we find out what are the protection enabled for particular binary file. So this is the vulnerable code I'm going to use for this demo. Here in foo function there is a vulnerability. It uses the getS function. We know that, right? GetS function does not check the input line. So I have already compiled the executable file for that vulnerable code with enabling the canary protection. This is the file which has a canary protection. So let's run this executable file. So I will give the input more than 40 byte. Usually what we get was a segmentation fault, right? Now we will get something called a stack smashed error. So stack smashing detected. So that means we overflow the buffer and overwrote the guard value. So because that guard value has been changed, now compiler will recheck that guard value. Because it is changed, it will give the error as stack smashing detected, and it will stop the execution there. So you can use checksec tool to find out what are the protection enabled for a particular binary file. And also you can use pound tool also. Let's see for this canary file. So you can see that here the canary is found. That means canary is enabled for this particular binary file. So I will discuss what is NX in the slide. I have mentioned what exactly NX means. And I didn't mention PI in the slide. So PI is basically, it will load the executable file in a different memory every time we run the program. So I will show the demo on PI also. I didn't mention this PI protection in the slide. Let me show a simple demo on PI protection. For PI protection demo, I have used this code. Here in main function, what it does is, it will print the foo function address every time we run the program. So I have two executable files. One is PI enabled, another one is PI is disabled. So let's see. This file is PI and PI is not enabled. For this file, PI is enabled. Let's check that using checksec. File PI. Yeah. For this file, PI is enabled. For no PI. Yeah, for this file, PI is not enabled. Okay. So first, let's run the file which has no PI protection. So you can see that this is the address for foo function. So if I run the same file multiple times, it will remain same. This is the same address as before, right? So if I run the binary file which has a PI protection, So this is the address for foo function. So if I run it again, it is changed, right? It is not same as before. So that's what happens in file protection. Every time we run the program, the executable file will be loaded into different memory location. So that's how you cannot hard code the value or address value in your payload. So earlier time we used the hackridge function address, right? We find out the hackridge function address using a GDB, and we use that address in a payload and we hard coded that address. So because for that binary file, phi was not enabled. So every time we run the program, that hackage function address remains same. If phi is enabled, we cannot hard code those address in our payload. So how can we bypass this phi protection? There are two way. One is leak the value. There is something called format string vulnerability. In the future, I will make a video on it. Using that vulnerability, we can leak the content present in the stack and find out what is the address of particular function. So the second way is brute force approach. Here what we do is we will assume the particular function value as some random possible value, and then we will run the program multiple times until we get the hit. So these are the two ways to bypass this phi protection. So far we have discussed how canary protection works. Let's discuss how can we bypass this protection. The technique is similar to bypassing the phi protection. First one is leak the value. Here, because guard value also pushed into stack, so we can use the format string vulnerability to leak the content present in the stack, and we can reuse this guard value in our payload, so that we will make sure that this guard value will be rewritten by same value. Then we will rewrite the return address by some useful address. So now what happens is compiler will recheck this guard value. It will be similar, right? So then it will redirect the control flow as we want. So second way is brute force approach. Here what we do is we will assume the canary value as some random possible value, and we will run the program multiple times until we get the hit. So this brute force technique is possible in 32-bit program. It is not feasible in 64-bit program. So these are the two ways we can bypass the canary protection. So coming to non-executable stack, this is the hardware protection. So here what it does is it will enable the NX bit. That means it will make the stack as non-executable. In previous video, we did this exploit, right? We put the shellcode into stack and we ran that shellcode and we gained the access. That worked because this protection was disabled. If this non-executable stack protection was enabled, that payload won't work, because whatever input given by the user will be treated as data. It won't be treated as instruction. So any attempt to run it as an instruction will crash the program. So there is a way to bypass this protection. There is a one attack called return to libc attack. In next video, I will make a hands-on session on this return to libc attack. So let's move to next slide. So coming to ASLR, this is the OS level protection. This is same as phi protection. So we have discussed the phi, right? It will randomize the base address of executable file every time we run the program. In ASLR, it will randomize the libc base address every time we run the program. So basically we cannot hard code the libc address in our payload. So this is the exact protection for return to libc attack. You will understand more in next video. So coming to bypass, one is leak the value. If there is a format string vulnerability, we can leak the libc address and we can utilize that address in our payload. And second way is brute force approach. So every brute force approach I have discussed so far, it is possible in 32-bit program, but it is not feasible in 64-bit program. So these are the two ways we can bypass this ASLR protection. So that's it. So until then, stay tuned, like the video and subscribe the channel.